Hi, welcome to Göteborg Film Festival and the release of the 8th Nostradamus Report called Transforming Storytelling Together. My name is Sia Edström and I'm the head of industry at the Göteborg Film Festival. And even though I have read the report, I'm just as excited as you are to hear what Johanna has to say. And before I hand it over to the analyst and the writer of the report, Johanna Koljonen, I want to say thank you to the report's lead partner, Filminvest. You will meet Thomas Eskesson, head of strategy at Filminvest, right after Johanna's presentation in a conversation about their upcoming report about on public financing in Europe. Last but not least, I want to thank the Region Västra Götaland, Nordisk Film and TV Fund, Creative Europe, and Kulturakademin for the additional support. And now please give a welcome to Johanna Koljonen.
Thank you very much, Sia. So, there we are. Nostradamus is a project commissioned by the Nordic Film Market at the Göteborg Film Festival. It looks into the near future of the screen industries. This is our 8th annual report, and you will be able to download it for yourself on the industry platform just after this session, and later, of course, also on the Film Festival webpage. I'll give you the link at the end. This project is a collaboration now with Filminvest, who are also our main partner, and our other supporters are also public, and it is a privilege to be tasked to think about the industry in this way. We do read a lot of numbers, we are very intensely interested in business models, but our interviewees and the report itself are encouraged to think more philosophically and artistically as well about the developments and what they mean. The perspectives are as much about values as about value. This year, our interviewees on whom the report is built are from the fields of virtual production, traditional production, exhibition, distribution, brand finance, film, broadcasting, streaming, public funding, financing, industry analysis, and curation. And in this report, you can read a generous amount of direct quotes from them. Those are theirs. The conclusions, as always, are mine. And if anything is wrong, I am the person whom you should send the angry emails. And I will start in the year 2020, or now, of course, spring of 2021. This is a core lesson, it's a picture of an empty cinema. This is a real place. Of course, cinemas are located in the real world, that is a trite observation when most of them in the world are closed. But also there's another lesson here. This industry is situated in the real world. Ecosystems, financial systems, global health, political systems. Whether the state of democracy or racial justice riots, global supply chains, extreme weather events like forest fires and floods messing up shooting schedules. We are part of the real world. And that became very tangible this year. We work with dreams. We talk about that often. We talk about art. Even industry is a very abstract term. But we do things and we make things and we create things and we trade things and exploit these values and rights. We are not just reflecting the world, we are acting in the world and the world is acting on us. 2020 was a year of constant climate emergency that barely broke the news because of the health emergency that was just on top of it, overshadowing everything. But I think that somehow we have taken notice, and this is a very core thing in all of these interviews. I found that even as we were asking our interviewees to look past the next 2 or 3 years, which will be very difficult and will be dominated still by the pandemic, to look to a 5-year horizon later, after. Even then, they were mentally thinking about the next crisis, because there will be another crisis. It's going to happen. And when it happens, the industry that we will be part of should be more resilient. We live in an unstable age. We have to be part of the solution, not the problem. My colleague Sia Edson talks about going from audience behavior to industry behavior in some of our focus in the next few years. And I think we will. How do we travel? How do we produce? How do we recruit? How do we cast? What is a safe workplace? And so on. This is going to be our focus forever, but especially in the next few years. But for this year's report, we tried to look past the pandemic, as I said, and to go to that five-year horizon. And the picture that is painted there is very hopeful. Business is booming. We are on the verge of very existing technical and artistic breakthroughs. We will go into the roaring 20s, and now it is time for a little warning and reminder. I do believe, yes, artistic creativity will bloom, the business will largely do very well. But there is a warning here. Let's see if I can... Yes, there we are. Oop. When I imagine living in the roaring 20s, I always imagine that I'm Zelda Fitzgerald, or like I'm Josephine Baker. I'm cool and alternative and creative, and I'm making something that didn't exist before. I'm a flapper, at the very least, dancing to dangerous music. But 100 years ago, I would still have been 42 years old. I would have been born in 1878. I would be the middle-aged lady in these pictures, in my corset and my hat, judging the young people, trying to understand what the heck they are doing. I would be scornful of modernism. I would be dismissive of jazz. I would assume that these young people are not just immoral, but utter idiots with no sense of history or culture. So before we go to talk about the future, we're going to go back in time, not 100 years, just 3 weeks or so, to January 11th. And we're going to go on an emotional journey with this young man, a nursing student in Texas named Promise Uzuwulu, whose brother Frank is also in the car. And now we're going to have a little quiz in the chat. His brother is selecting the music here, and Promise is feeling judgy about the music. 2 or 3 days after this video was taken, it was shared in a lot of mainstream media. And my pop quiz question to you is, what was the context? What is happening here? Okay, this is lit. The context was sea shanty TikTok, the international explosion of excitement about Scottish, Irish, English, in this case New Zealander sea shanties, which is a genre of working man's music that goes back at least 500 years. Sea shanties had been growing in popularity on TikTok most of last year, but the breakthrough was provided by Nathan Evans, a 26-year-old Scottish postman who is also a folk singer. Last July, someone requested that he record a sea shanty. That went well. He posted some more. On December 27th, he posted this one, and this one really took off. Here we are on TikTok. Now, the following day, Boxing Day of last year, Luke Taylor here, who's singing the bass, I think he's 23 years old. Since this video was posted, he has added at least 200,000 followers to his TikTok. He also sings country and evergreens. Now, what is going on here is a format called duets, where you record yourself singing along to a TikTok made by somebody else. And of course, somebody else can then do a duet with your film and so on and so on. And of course, this rapidly becomes a branching tree with hundreds of different variants. And people were really getting into shanty talk. And the only reason I even know about this is that I used to sing folk music in the 90s when I was a teenager and world music was hot. Honestly, it hadn't occurred to me that young people might still be into this, but apparently they are. We are now 13 days into the reign of sea shanty TikTok. And that is how long it took for electro shanty to be invented. What can I say? This is it. The shameful. You can imagine my children going, oh my God, mom, don't use those kinds of words. Now, this phenomenon was picked up on mainstream media, so I would guess at least half of you had already heard about it. And maybe you hadn't. And maybe you wouldn't have if folk music nerds in middle age like me wouldn't have gotten so excited about this also. Millions of young people, though, were into this. Now, this is not a competition. It's not, my question isn't like, oh, have you heard about this? My question is, do you have TikTok on your phone? Like, honestly, do you have TikTok on your phone? My question is, do you have anyone working with you today who can explain why sea shanties, hundreds of years old, would appeal to two black students in their car in Texas and to literally millions of other young adults all over the world? And if not, do you at least know how to find out about this stuff online? Those are my questions. Now your questions probably, why on earth is she talking about this? Two reasons. One, when audiences in general, and young audiences in particular, are doing something that we consider to be the wrong way, and we feel it is super annoying, and we ask ourselves, why don't they just do things the way we want them to do? Why don't they just behave the way people did before? Why don't they like the things in the same way, the same thing, so that I can go on making my living in peace? That's when you have to remember that we are the Victorians. They are inventing modernity, and 100 years from now, people like us are going to look back on them and know that when they did everything wrong and misunderstood everything and had no sense of history, they created all of the things that people like us in the future will consider to be right. Two, second reason. We think we know what young people are into, and we often also think we know what young people are not interested in. And we'd say, you know, young people are not interested in art house cinema, auteur cinema, no, art is wasted on the young. Young people are not interested in old things like sea shanties. And usually when we say that, we are operating on incredibly bad data, the worst kind of data, namely no data at all. We are just operating on our assumptions. And that is not a good strategy for creating relevance in a marketplace. Now we are ready to talk about the future. Okay. Theatrical is not dying, it's changing. It is probably true that 5 years from now we will have fewer cinemas operating on the current model, but those cinemas are likely to do pretty well. In a way we could say, and I mean this is a truism of course, but the films that will disappear from cinemas are the films that can't perform in cinemas. Many of those cinemas will be focused on blockbusters, scheduled ages in advance, reliable in performance. They may have a short exclusive window of 2 to 3 weeks. There might be a premium, or there almost certainly will be a premium digital window, either just after or in parallel, or even sometimes just before that theatrical premiere. What has definitely disappeared is the dead window, where after a premiere, where films are not available anywhere legally. You will only have to market them once, and for most films, this is actually a win-win all across the value chain. There will also be a very profitable market in bourgeois upmarket cinemas for old ladies like me, who are interested in and able to afford to splurge on a cultural night out, sometimes watching something very eclectic because I like how that makes me feel. And in both of these kinds of cinemas, but especially the latter, there certainly is room for some art house film. Even so, it's clear that the theatrical market for independent film is shrinking. However, cinemas will close, and that means that there will be cinema real estate drifting around, and I'm pretty sure, and this is not so much from the experts a little bit, but mostly from talking to young people in this field, I think that there's a lot of excitement about alternative exhibition. If it's possible to get your hands on cinemas in some way through an arts institution or with a municipal partner or even some kind of nonprofit situation and run it experimentally as a different kind of event venue, I think it is. I think that is exactly what is going to happen with a lot of these places. And I think we will in fact have a kind of blooming and flourishing cinema-going culture. But of course, because they will be working very specifically with specific audiences locally and or for specific screenings, that means, and they will also do many other kinds of events and businesses to make it work financially, that means that that market can't in itself sustain the amount of indie cinema that we used to make or art house cinema. But it does mean that there are ways to audience also in the theatrical space, even for incredibly niche films, and this I find very exciting. Let's not give up, especially on those under 25s, by the way, in the theatrical space. They are going to see the blockbusters after all, and if we can make the content appeal to them, I'm sure they will reinvent exhibition in a way that works for them. The heart is a small screen. And by that, I mean the heart of the industry in particular. And this sounds like a trivial thing, but the more I think about this, the more this is like the most provocative opinion. I would have hated myself not very long ago for making this observation, but now I think it's unavoidably true. Now, obviously, we know now that functionally and in every way, in fact, film and TV are now the same industry. It's the same production companies, the same talent, even often the same projects. You start with something that you thought might be a feature film. It turns out it's maybe a limited series. Oh, it moves back and forth between the platforms in development until it finds its shape and its home. Audiences, of course, are way ahead of us and have been here for a very long time. At least, I mean, for decades, the majority of the films that we see, even film fans like myself, the greatest number of them, of course, has been in the living room this whole time. But I think that many of us have maintained that idea that cinema is the temple in a way, that is the ritual, and certainly the definition of what is a real film, like real feature film, as we have seen also in many cultural debates, in particularly in France, but everywhere I feel in Europe. The idea has been that the theatrical premiere is somehow part of the definition of what the format is. And it has also been the financial heart of our business model. So in artistic and in the economic sense, it has made sense for us to center the idea of the theatrical experience. But if it is correct, as we think now that it is, that the theatrical marketplace will specialize and in some ways shrink, then not every film will have a theatrical premiere. Those that weren't working in theatrical anyway will just not be released that way. But they are still films. The audience agrees, the filmmakers agree, everybody agrees that those are still films. And then by definition, the importance of the theatrical window is going to recede over time, especially as we are now seeing a lot of commissioning of feature films from small screen operators, like for instance Netflix and Sky, also others, for instance public service broadcasters have very different strategies in this space. This means that the historical gatekeepers, who have had a lot of control and power over defining film and the meaning of film and access to the places where film's outcomes are determined, those gatekeepers, they can be funding bodies, they can be programmers at A festivals, they can be powerful distributors, their power is diminishing. And other stakeholders with other kinds of values and priorities, perhaps an other understanding of the audience, will gain more power. This is traumatic and painful, especially if you have power in the old system. And I don't know exactly what the outcome of this will be, but it's worth considering because I think it's important. In practical TV terms, we know that household SVOD spend will grow, but also other kinds of complementary business models for like advertising, finance, streaming will of course be there in parallel. All television essentially will be streaming in one way or the other. And one outcome of this over time is that even though right now there's a big focus on exclusive global rights, that's not where the market is heading. So you will be able to sell platform by platform or territory by territory, and that is going to expand the market for everybody and of course especially for content from smaller countries. The small screen will be the financial heart of the industry and it will quite possibly be the artistic heart of this industry. Very difficult for me individually to accept, but I think that is the case. And I think we're already seeing it in how the formats are blending at the edges. What is film? What is a limited series? Interesting things happening with between short format TV drama and short film. And the other methods of storytelling, I think, across all of these formats will gain more space. So then how do we release content? Well, if we don't have a window system, how is this going to work? And the answer is kind of nobody knows. But the real way, the correct way I think of thinking about that is that everybody decides, you decide. We all decide. We can all participate right now, between today and let's say the next 3 years, we are going to decide together what this landscape is going to look like. Now, the biggest companies are very clear in what they largely want to do. They are setting out, you know, the US major studios are setting out their strategies, the global streamers are setting out their strategies. And if we are only reactive, if we're like looking at them like they're a storm, and we're like, oh, you know, then they get to decide. Of course, that's how this works. We need to start thinking about how would we want this to work? How would you, in your work as a broadcaster, as a commissioner, as a funder, as a director, as a production company owner, whatever you do, especially if you're in sales and distribution, how would you like this to work? Can you find one deal, just one project, and try to make it work the way you would want this to work? there is often a defeatist tone when we talk about these bigger players because of their incomparable economic muscle. And of course, they're always going to take the best deal on offer. They're privately owned companies. They are legally required pretty much to serve the interest of their owners. But owners have very different kinds of interest. It's not always about maximizing the profit in the short term. And there are assets that they need, resources in this market. Content is one. Original creativity, specificity in content, and therefore also talent. All of these are assets that are incredibly valuable in this booming market. And that means that there are ways of negotiating. Of course, if you go in expecting to be defeated and not asking for anything, they're going to give you the worst deal they can. So let's not go in like that. And we know that there are many of examples already where quietly even major streamers are making very different kinds of deals. The kinds of deals that they, formally speaking, aren't supposed to be doing because for some reason it's worth it. So if you go in there, let's make damn sure that whatever you want is worth it for them. But I think it's just important to look beyond these 3 or 5 or 10 globally dominant companies. The rest of the ecosystem is also not going away. Small stakeholders can work together in different ways to scale up our resources, our competence, and our reach. Sales and distribution are in trouble. We've come from a position where sales and distribution are very business-to-business oriented. Everything has always worked in the same way. It's been sort of predictable. And I don't mean, it's difficult to say this because I know that nobody has worked harder. And the landscape has already changed so much in the last 5 years, in the last 10 years, that it's not weird if you're in sales or distribution and you're exhausted and you're like, I just figured this out. I don't want it to change again. But it is also very clear that those who have diversified their businesses, those who have moved up the value chain towards development and production and financing, or those who have moved down the value chain towards, for instance, streaming and exhibition, are largely doing better now. But there are going to be a lot of specialties because, and this is the part where this gets fun and exciting, we have to start thinking, okay, film is now basically streaming. Like all of our content, basically, regardless of format, is streaming. That's the heart. So if I don't get a theatrical premiere, what could be a premiere? And the answer is literally anywhere that has the capacity to stream video and collect an audience at the same time could be a premiere venue. That can be a streamer, that can be a broadcaster, that can be an international conglomeration of collaborating small independent art house streaming services across the world. It could be on free television for maybe just for one day to create an event. It could be on an influencers or in the platforms of like 17 core influencers who are important to that audience. It could be in a bunch of places. Yes, I mean, of course, there needs to be an income model attached. That could be connected to brands, that could be connected to direct purchases from the audiences. There's very many ways of solving this. But then, of course, we also know that attention in itself is also a currency. So perhaps we will put less money and effort into marketing and more into placing it already in certain groups to drive transactional streaming purchases further along in the value chain of the piece. But you hear the problem. This is going to be project by project. And probably, if you're in sales or distribution, you're going to specialize on some kind of audience category or some aspect of a larger territory and become the best at connecting the audience resources, the financing resources, and the content for each project. And another important thing I want to say about this is that we can't afford to get this wrong. And I keep coming back to those under 25s, but the under 25s are not super excited, like on average, about traditional film and TV content. Yes, they watch a lot of it, and yes, there are a lot of them who are also incredibly passionate about art house storytelling. Like art house TikTok is a whole thing. You can read about it in the report. But they are consuming most of their video content on other platforms than traditional TV, streaming, film. And they are producing it in those places. And this is a generation that has been communicating with video since they were literally children, probably many of them since before they could write. They're pretty good at it. Like, even amateur content can be incredibly compelling and really compete in attention with professionals. But in addition to this, there is also the fact happening now that a lot of professionals, either established professionals who want the creative freedom, or young professionals who just can't get their big break, are also moving outside the traditional production infrastructure and using the very accessible production technologies and the incredibly accessible distribution platforms to create their own direct-to-consumer models. And maybe 5 years ago or 10 years ago, this was kind of like the content was maybe a little bit shit, or maybe it wasn't, you know, you couldn't really scale it up unless you were YouTubing every day. It was very difficult to make a living out of that, but that is actually changing. Very few of them will build businesses in the sense of hiring a great number of people and growing and growing and growing. But it's possible to make a very decent living there. And it's not always possible to make a decent living in traditional film and television, and that is a very appealing prospect. So here again, it comes back to that idea of industry behavior and what is sustainable, what is a sustainable and resilient industry, how do we also make ourselves attractive to the talent and to every kind of worker who is working with us, as well as making the content relevant to the audience. And I think we can't disconnect this from each other. And of course, that also means that also on the traditional side, we need to be better at these alternative distribution models. Yeah. Virtual production is an umbrella term for filmmaking or elements of filmmaking that use the manipulation of 3D modeling, normally now inside game engine tools, and often with visual effects captured in camera, that is, in a normal film camera, you have the visual effects shot through that. Even though they are digital, they may be present, for instance, as in Disney's The Mandalorian, pictured here. They may be present on LED screens in the studio, and that is how you employ these virtual sets in a physical shooting environment. Now, I'm not going to go deep into the technology here. And if you already felt that your brain glazed over and you can't follow this because I said words that you're not very interested in or that you don't understand or you're intimidated by this technology, please, please read that chapter. I think that I've explained it in a way that is accessible even if you don't have any background with this at all. And there are also some pointers for where to start learning more about this. There are a few important things to know about virtual production. One is that 5 years from now, these methods and tools and the pipelines will have been completely normalized across the industry. You will probably be using virtual production tools, at least in pre-visualization, in pre-production, probably also for effects, probably also for remote location work. I think that will be available here. So one of the ways that what things we need to understand about this, if you haven't, you know, been paying attention a lot the last year, because what happened in 2020, because a lot of shoots had to shut down, was that this technology accelerated faster than expected. We thought that we would be at this point maybe 4 years from now. It's happening now because it's just been developed so much. It helps a lot with remote work pipelines, and also it's possible, of course, to do this in a photorealistic way now, which means that you can send out like a 1-3 person team to capture a real environment and bring the environment to the virtual or physical studio and work with it there. And in a world where we can't travel, that's so important. If you're in animation, you're of course even further ahead of the curve because a lot of these tools come from animation. So that the way we work there has completely changed. But what is also happening is that here is that a lot of the post-production work, a lot of the VFX are moving up the production pipeline into pre-production. And this is really good news for everybody. It's going to save you money, it's going to make the outcomes more predictable, it's going to re-empower department heads, maybe set designers and costume designers and so on, who felt that they were disconnected from what the VFX people were doing. Now everybody will be able to iterate together. And that also, of course, gives the director much more control of what is happening. The work industry here is enormous, enormous. And the good news, the best news about this is that, yes, it's most expensive and it's most complex, like what Disney is doing with The Mandalorian. Setting that up is very expensive today. But those costs of that infrastructure and of that software goes down month by month. And we already know that there's development in Europe in this field, so you will be able to find professionals to work within that field. But at the lowest budget end, you can start working in a professional way with fully virtual productions, with equipment that starts at a few hundred euros. And to actually learn about it, you can go on YouTube, you can find an app like CineTracer and start to practice some of these principles that you will be able to employ immediately, also in the sort of more expensive and even more professional, so to speak, setups. But today already it's possible for a very small team to make an animation that would have required a full studio just 5 or 10 years ago. And I think 5 years from now, we will have seen the first big genre movies of a type we haven't been able to make in markets like the Nordic. And of course, also this means that once you have the digital assets for a film, you may also use those same digital assets for a game or a VR experience. And now the whole game, the whole artistic limitations, again, of what is a film and what are we doing, what belongs to this industry, is also very rapidly shifting. And it's just an enormous opportunity. Speaking of opportunities, there's a lot going on in the world right now. There are political shifts, there are cultural shifts. The media market, of course, is globalizing. The technology is changing the playing field here. And a lot of the big players have their own reasons to encourage content from different markets to travel. And I think everybody agrees that, that local content is of vital importance in that content's local market, but also that it has that global potential. And if we're looking at this just from a European perspective, which makes sense since that's where we are, this is a historically unique opportunity. And yeah, I think I said before that feature film numbers are expected to shrink, certainly the ones that are intended primarily for a theatrical release, but production volumes overall are expected to stay very strong, probably even to grow. At some point, the TV drama market will even out, but the question is how much it will even contract. We'll see, there might be other reasons why that would happen, global financial trends and so on, but it's not going to be an issue of demand. Now, our policies perhaps are not entirely up to date with what is happening in this industry. And it's not weird, it's not strange that our bureaucrats aren't entirely up to date when we who work with this every day are finding it difficult to catch up. And I just have to mention that for this very reason, I'm passionately interested in this stuff. And still, every year I've been like, so talk to me again, like explain to me again the Audiovisual Media Services Directive, like what is going on with that? Did we implement it? What's going on? So this time, instead of trying with that, I turned to an expert who is Petri Kempinen. You know him perhaps from his previous role at Nordisk Film och TV Fond. Now he is a consultant. He just wrote a chapter for the Nostradamus Report, which you can download after my talk, to just tell us, okay, what is going on with the Audiovisual Media Services Directive? This is the one that means that streaming services operating in European markets have to have 30% European content. That's working fine. But there's also that little optional clause where countries can choose to impose financial levies in different ways on these players if they want to. And some countries in Europe don't, and some countries do. Most, in fact, do. That seems to be the tendency. And there's you can read more about this in the report. But this does awaken a very, or raise a very important question. What even is film policy? Across Europe, audiovisual strategy is very often, typically I would say, conducted with focus on the national market and competition and structures inside the national market. Perhaps these structures were even constructed at a time when cinemas were being challenged by the introduction of television. That's often when some of this public funding machinery emerges. There are also, of course, other historical reasons. And certainly, on the policy level, we tend in Europe, not everywhere, but in a lot of places, we tend to treat film and television and online as though they are completely separate industries. But everything that I've been saying today of course, means that that's just not how this works anymore. That is just not financially true, or perhaps not even artistically true, for the content that we are actually making or for the day-to-day of our actual work. And certainly, when we're looking at how production is changing, it's going to be even harder to set those sort of hard limits. Now, if you have cultural policy goals, specifically for film, having to do with the protection of your language, the support of locally unique artistic traditions, representation goals for different aspects of your culture, country and your population, and so on, I would say that you can't fulfill those goals if that policy is not coherent with your policy for public service broadcasting, your policy for the wider broadcasting ecosystem in your countries, or your goals for the audiovisual sector as part of the creative economy as a whole. Now, these cultural policy goals are super, super, super important. I'm not suggesting that we should dump them and just like try to become part of the audiovisual sector. What I'm saying is that we are part of the audiovisual sector, but we have to fight for this. We have to fight for these cultural policy goals. And because we have to fight for them, we cannot afford to be marginalized into some kind of such tiny piece of the budget that the finance minister of your country forgets every day that we even exist as an industry. Those cultural policy goals need to be legible to the system of the state and to the systems of industry for us to have any chance to even reach them or to fulfill them. And that means that it's important that we are situated in a wider creative sector. And the film industry is one of the engines of that creative economy. We know that there's research to prove that. And now, again, like, how do you even define if you also count in the whole television economy and the whole computer gaming economy, for instance? Then we're starting to talk about some really significant numbers, certainly in the types of economies that dominate in Europe. And we have to change our policies to match that. And this is urgent. This is an urgent action that I think all of us can do through our unions, through our industry organizations, and so on. We have to liaise with colleagues in the sectors closest to our own. And weirdly, only as I was reading back the Nostradamus report after we had finished it, did I realize that there's this theme that runs through the whole, through every chapter, really. We will redefine industry behavior together, because we have to. We will shape the business models together, because we can, and the outcomes are going to be so much better if everybody is involved in identifying these goals and figuring out the win-win scenarios to do positive disruption together. We will shape these new formats, and we will shape these new artistic languages in which we can expand auteur filmmaking outside of that one platform where it has dominated historically into all of these other platforms, and we can do that together. And we will work with those under 25s, we will work together with them, and we will listen to them. And those of us who sometimes find it challenging, middle-aged ladies like me, we can sit and grumble together and then go out and listen to those kids some more. Hence the name of the report, Transforming Storytelling Together. I genuinely believe that that's what we're going to do. I mean, that's going to happen regardless, in a way. And now is the time to decide in these next 3 years, which are going to be very dark and difficult, unfortunately, especially if we're looking at the spread numbers of these, at the R numbers of these new mutations of the virus. This can get a lot worse before it gets better. But we know that after that, it's going to be pretty great. And we can be part of shaping what that after is going to look like. Göteborgfilmfestival.se/Nostradamus, that's where you can find all of our content in the future, possibly even this presentation. That is certainly where you will be able to download the report eventually if you don't have the privilege of finding it on the industry platform right now. I would like to thank Filmivest for their generous support of this project, and of course also for all this knowledge that we always get access to there. I would really like to thank the Göteborg Film Festival, which you have probably seen in the news this year for some of their inventive takes in celebrating art house cinema. I'm thinking about that nurse who is on an island in a lighthouse watching movies right now. Of course, in particular, I would like to thank the Nordic Film Market and C.I. Edström and Josef Kullegård. It's been such a privilege to work with you. And Josef is moving on, and I have no idea how we're going to do this without him. We will see. My contact information is inside the report on page 2. Get in touch. I am so happy that you may or may not be listening. Maybe you're not listening. Maybe you fell down a sea shanty hole about 40 minutes ago and have not returned to this tab since. That's also okay. Thank you very much. In just a few moments, I will have a conversation about another super interesting report with Thomas Eskilsson from Film I Väst. Thank you.